What's going on, guys? The Comics Kid 2099 here to examine an issue of the X-Men. We are on X-Men issue 32, edited by Stan Lee, written by Roy Thomas, with pencils by Werner Roth, inks by John Tartaglione, and lettering by Sam Rosen. This is the issue that brings back the Juggernaut. This is the first time that we have seen him since issue 13, and if you haven't read that issue, don't worry. This one will kind of sum things up. We kind of split our time between Xavier. We finally find out what is behind the secret door that he has been thinking about for the last several issues. It's the Juggernaut. He's in a coma. Apparently, after his defeat in issue 13, Xavier turned him over to the authorities, and then he managed to get custody of him, and he's been trying to find a way to take away Kane Marco's Juggernaut powers so that he can heal his mind so that Kane isn't filled with hate. And then, meanwhile, most of the X-Men are at a birthday party for Iceman. It's his 18th birthday. So, apparently, we just completely missed his 17th birthday, because I am 99% sure that he was 16 when the series first began. So at this time, we don't really have a sliding timescale that would eventually take effect on the Marvel Universe. Characters will age, so it's been at least a year and a half since the original X-Men issue 1, and that kind of lines up with about how much time has passed in real life, because at one point, the series was going bi-monthly, once every 2 months, and at this point, I think the X-Men issue 1 started in 63. I think this issue came out in 66. So that kind of lines up with about how much time has passed in the comic, I think. But it's Bobby's 18th birthday, and everyone is there except for Warren. And at first I thought they didn't invite him, but he shows up a little late after they've already sliced the cake with Candy Southern, who was introduced a couple issues ago, or the previous issue, I can't remember. But anyway, they're there, and then a biker gang busts through the window. They are at the Coffee A Go-Go. We get to see Bernard the Poet once again. He's bumming for a piece of cake. And then this biker gang shows up, and apparently their leader asked Zelda, that's Bobby's on-again, off-again girlfriend, asked her out on a date. She said no. So then we get several pages of the X-Men trying to fight these bikers without revealing their powers to anyone in the Coffee A Go-Go. And basically, this is just to waste time. At the very first page of this issue, there's a little editor's note that says, "We're sorry, we couldn't fit everything into one issue, so this is going to be a two-parter." I don't mind a two-parter if it actually warrants being a two-parter, but this does not. When you read this issue, it's very clear that they are trying to pad everything out so that they don't have to try and figure out what to do next issue. There is an entire page-long flashback of Professor X remembering how Kane Marco got his powers as the Juggernaut and then how he was defeated back in issue 13. You didn't need that. All you had to have was one panel of Xavier thinking about, you know, my brother, he got powers in Korea, and then we defeated him a little while back. You didn't need an entire page reminding us of this. If we've read the issue, we remember, and if we haven't read the issue, you've got a little editor's note telling us which issues to go and find. You did not need an entire page doing this, and then you didn't need 5 pages of the X-Men fighting these bikers who busted through the Coffee A Go-Go. That was completely nonsensical. And then it's about halfway into the issue before any of the X-Men make it back to the mansion. And Warren, he walks in and all the lights are off and he's thinking, I don't like this. I don't know where Xavier is. There's no sign of him. So he suits up as Angel. And I was thinking, this reminds me of that storyline where Magneto took over the mansion and he was knocking off the X-Men one by one and he put them all in the hot air balloon. And just as I was thinking of that, the issue actually reminds me of that. Warren says something like, this reminds me of that one time Magneto took over the mansion. And there's a little footnote reminding you of which issue that was. It was like 17 or something. And then, fortunately, the issue does not repeat that. I thought they were going to do that. I thought this was just going to be the same thing, but the Juggernaut knocking them off as they each arrived home instead of Magneto. Fortunately, it does do things a little differently. All the X-Men pretty much arrive at the same time. For some reason, Warren was searching the house with the lights off, and so he briefly scuffles with Beast, and then they turn the lights on. It's like, oh, sorry. And then they find the Juggernaut. They fight him for a couple pages, and I should mention mention, Juggernaut actually has Xavier's telepathic powers, because Xavier hooked himself up to some kind of machine with Juggernaut trying to remove his Juggernaut powers, and then there was an explosion. Xavier's knocked unconscious, and Juggernaut has Xavier's telepathy. In theory, that sounds terrifying, because the Juggernaut was already nearly impossible to defeat, and now he has Xavier's powers, so he's even more powerful. Except that Juggernaut doesn't really use these powers. Now, you could argue that Juggernaut doesn't know how. He has no training, so he's just sticking to what he knows. And if the issue kind of made that a little bit clear, I'd be fine with that. But don't set this up as, oh no, the most powerful villain that the X-Men have ever fought is now even more powerful, and then you don't do anything with that. He's basically just messing around with the X-Men. He doesn't bother killing anybody. He leaves Xavier unconscious and figures, that's good enough. He fights the X-Men a little bit, but he's mostly just kind of pranking them. At one point, he turns the stairs into a ramp and makes them slide down the stairs. That's all he does. He kind of messes around with them, but he doesn't do any damage. And then he gets a message from Factor 3. I didn't think we were ever going to get a conclusion to Factor 3. It feels like it's been 10,000 years since we saw any of the agents of Factor 3 fighting the X-Men for several issues now. Xavier has been saying, Factor 3 is still a threat, but not in this issue. And finally, Factor 3 says, we are the reason that this machine malfunctioned and you have Xavier's telepathy, so you should join us. And Juggernaut says, I don't join anyone. I'm my own man, but I will join you because I want to, and not because you want me to. And I don't like that. Juggernaut is not the kind of guy who's going to join an organization that he knows nothing about. He's going to get there, and then they're going to try and give him an order, and he's going to say, no, I don't follow orders. He doesn't seem like the kind of person who it would make sense for him to just go and join Factor 3. It would have made a little bit more sense if he said, I don't like the sound of these guys. They sound like they could be a threat to me, so I'm going to go, and I'm going to defeat them, and then I can take over the world. That would have made more sense, and then if you wanted to keep building up Factor 3 as the menace that this series wants us to think that they are, Factor 3 could find some way to take away Juggernaut's telepathy that he got from Xavier, and then the X-Men could find Juggernaut defeated, and it's like, oh no, Factor 3 is even more of a menace than what we thought. That would have been good. It would have been a little bit more in line with Juggernaut's characterization, and we would have had more of a buildup of Factor 3. I don't know what's going to happen in the next issue. I have read it. It's just been a really long time. I don't think that Juggernaut's going to stay allied with Factor 3 for very long. I do wish this had been a little less padded. This does remind me of today when you buy any random issue off the stands and it's part of a 6-part storyline that feels like it could be a 2 or 3-part storyline. If you removed this nonsensical fight with the biker gang, if you removed the page-long flashback of the Juggernaut, this could have been about half as long as it was. And I'm really looking forward to the time when we get storylines that actually feel like they need to be as long as they are, or when you can just have a standalone story that doesn't need to be padded out to 2 or 3 issues long. It seems like we have to have one or the other. We can't just have issues that are as long as they need to be. And I get that some padding is probably going to be necessary. If you have a story that feels like it's only 16 pages long and your issue is going to be 22 pages long, there's going to be a little bit of padding, but you don't have to continue everything. I guess what I'm saying is, it reminds me of Glenn Murakami. I'm way off topic here, but I'm going to go ahead and finish this thought. Glenn Murakami, he was the showrunner of the Teen Titans cartoon, and he talked about how you might start an episode with Mumbo as the bad guy, and then they may defeat Mumbo in 3 minutes, and then they might fight Slade for the rest of the episode. You could do something like that with the X-Men. If Juggernaut gets defeated in 10 pages because you didn't pad everything out, then have Magneto show up, or have Mastermind, or the Sentinels, something like that, and then you can continue into the next issue if you have to. It feels like you're kind of dragging people along, but in a good way, because someone can get to the end of the issue and it's like, whoa, the Sentinels just showed up after they defeated Juggernaut. I have to find out what happens next. You don't have to begin and end each adventure at the beginning of the issue and the end of the issue. And also, you don't have to stretch an adventure out to be 2 issues long when it really doesn't feel like it needs to be. This issue, the Scott and Jean stuff. Scott does tell Jean that he feels like he has to kind of guard himself emotionally because he has incredibly dangerous mutant abilities and he doesn't want anyone to get hurt. I don't buy it. There are a lot of dangerous mutants out there. In the X-Men, Xavier is incredibly dangerous. At this moment, Jean doesn't have telepathy, but her telekinesis, if gone unchecked, could be very dangerous. Iceman, if he gets more powerful, he could be very dangerous. Warren and Beast, yeah, they're not too dangerous, but Cyclops acts like because he has his mutant abilities that he has to be all quiet and reserved and not talk to anyone, and that just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Granted, some people just don't like talking to people. this guy. Sometimes, Cyclops, you don't need a reason. Now, if you like Jean, as you profess that you do, maybe you should tell her. Because he even tells her, like, so that's kind of why I keep to myself. And then Jean is thinking, okay, do you want pity, or are you looking for someone to love? And then he's thinking, yeah, I love her, and I need to tell her soon. Why? Why wait? Why not just tell her now? You're in the middle of a park. It's beautiful outside. Go ahead and tell her. Just get it over with. Even if things don't work out, at least make a move. I am sick and tired of this relationship. It's been 32 issues, 3 years, and nothing has happened except Scott likes Jean, Jean likes Scott. I do not understand why people like the Silver Age X-Men. I see so many people who talk about how Silver Age X-Men was underappreciated and it was really good. I don't think it was. I do not like this. I wish that there would be some momentum here. Maybe have them go on a date and it goes horribly. Scott accidentally says something that hurts Jean's feelings and she doesn't want anything to do with him. Something like that. And I know that the people working on these books are capable of good storytelling. You look at the Silver Age Spider-Man stuff that was going on at this time. There was some really solid relationship stuff going on in that series. Much better, leagues better than what's going on here. You also have Warren. He likes Candy, and he asks her out on a date for next Saturday, and she says no. She already has a something planned for that day. She says a long-standing date or something like that. And Warren is kind of moping to himself, like, I really like her, but I don't want her to just be a rebound girl because I'm getting over Jean. And why can't the X-Men tell people that they love that they are mutants? Why did Jean's parents not know that she's a mutant? Beast, I don't remember. I think we're going to find this out later on whenever we get the little standalone origins for the characters. But Beast, his parents don't know that he is a mutant because Xavier wiped their minds. Why? I get that you want some level of secrecy about your headquarters. You don't want people to know that you are a mutant, Xavier. But if Scott falls in love with some civilian out in the outside world, why can't he tell her that he's a mutant? Or Angel, Iceman, Beast, they're all in some level of relationship with people who are not students at the school. What happens if this gets serious? Why can't they tell them, hey, Zelda, I'm a mutant? And then if she screams, Xavier has already shown that he has no problems wiping people's minds. He's done it a couple times. The Blob, the Vanisher, he kind of put Juggernaut in a coma. So if Iceman tells Zelda, I'm a mutant and I want to spend the rest of my life with you, and she says, no, I'm a bigot, I don't like mutants, then Xavier can wipe her mind. No problem. You've already done this before. I don't understand why there has to be so much relationship drama here that could very easily be avoided. Warren really likes Candy Southern. Candy seems to like Warren. If you're gonna do the nasty, at some point I'm assuming these two are gonna try and get with each other in the bedroom. Is he gonna keep his shirt on? You're gonna have to tell her that you're a mutant at some point. Why can't he just tell her? I don't understand this. Now later on, when you get into the Bronze Age, this becomes less of a problem. You have characters like Wolverine is in a relationship with Mariko, and she's not a mutant, but she knows that he is. So at some point, it kind of stops being a big deal, but right now, I don't understand why it is a big deal. I get that secret identities are a thing, but being a mutant is not your superhero identity. These guys are mutants all the time. They can't help that. Now, Cyclops said he didn't want to be a superhero anymore. At one point, he was considering leaving the X-Men. Beast was very tempted to leave the X-Men at one point. If these guys don't want to be superheroes, that's fine, but they're always going to be mutants. And it seems like Xavier doesn't want these guys to have a personal life outside of being X-Men. And, of course, we're not going to explore anything like that for many years. It'll be an Ultimate X-Men in the 2000s before we get anything where characters are thinking that Xavier is kind of using his psychic powers to take over their lives and take away their free will. But it'd be nice if we could have something where someone says, hey, why can't I tell my girlfriend that I'm a mutant? I don't know. I just feel like that's something that it would be cool to explore. But anyway, that's about all that I have for this issue. The X-Men are going to have to go on their own against the Juggernaut, who has Professor Xavier's telepathic powers. Xavier is in a coma. Juggernaut is going to go and form an alliance with Factor 3. The stakes have never been higher, so I can't wait to be disappointed by next issue. So in the meantime, consider this issue examined.